Concord Baptist Church. I'd like to welcome you if you are a visitor. I'd like to welcome you if you are a member already. We are just excited to have you here at Concord. And we are excited to see what the Lord's going to do this morning. I've got just a couple of announcements I need to take care of. Revival will start next Sunday morning with Scott Huffman preaching. That evening, however, we will still have our men's and women's monthly meetings, and you can see those on the back of the bulletin for info on those. And then this Wednesday, our love banquet will happen at 6 p.m. In the fellowship hall, there's a sign up over here. We would love if you were planning to come, if you could sign up just to give our kitchen helpers and food preparers an idea of numbers. That will make that a lot easier on them. Other than that, there's a good many announcements in the bulletin. After church today, I'm excited. A chili fellowship will happen in the church right after morning worship for lunchtime. Come eat lunch. It's just a donation to eat. Also, they will be voting on, we will be voting. You can taste test all the chilies and vote on your favorites. And they will be giving out prizes for the best chilies. But there is a lot of good smelling chili going on in that fellowship hall. So please come eat with us. It is all for the youth summer camp fund. So anything you can donate for that will be greatly appreciated as well. Let's pray. Well, let's pray. You good? I had started.
There's flyers up there for revival. I'd like to do those and then, or hang them up somewhere this week.
There's flyers a little bigger than this on the table right up front. So if you have a place that would be good to post one of those, we'd love for you to come get one and hang it up this week to prepare for revival coming up. All right. Father God, we just thank you so much for everything you do for us, Lord. We just thank you for, God, your Son that you sent to die on the cross for us. God, he chose to live that perfect life, and God, he chose that death. We know he was God as well, and he could have pulled himself down off the cross, but God, he chose to suffer and die for us. We're so thankful for that. Let everything we do today bring glory to your name, whether we say it, sing it, or do it. Let us be glorifying you. We love you so much. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Stand with me as we sing Stand in Your Love.
Broken and sin. says this for our scripture reading, I give you a new command, love one another. And just as I have loved you, you are also to love one another. But by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Roger, would you come, please, in our congregation prayer time? You can be seated. During this time, I invite you to the altar as well, if you'd like to join us for prayer.
This time, altar's open. A few I'm going to mention today. Dessa Bailey and Kulin White, both of them are down at Shelby Hospital. And keep them in your prayers. And continue to remember Betty Hambrick and Bronnie. Bronnie Hambrick got upcoming surgery. And I know there's some others, but a couple I would like to mention, friends of mine, Dr. Douglas Owens, keep him in your prayers. And Jennifer Crawley, both of them are facing cancer issues. And so at this time, we'll go to the Lord in prayer. Father, as we come to you today, Father, we just thank you that we're able to be out in your house today, Father. And Father, we just ask that the ones I've mentioned here, and we know Odessa and Tulin both is down in Shelby, and Father, I just especially want to lift them up to you, Father, and just be with the doctors that they can find the problem, if that be your will. Father, continue to be with Betty Hamrick, just be with her. And Father, others that I mentioned, you know the need there, Father. And we just ask that you be with them. Father, be in your service today. Just be with Jamie and the choir, and be with Travis as he brings the word to us today. Just give us open minds and open hearts to receive your word. And Father, we just love you. We give you the honor and the praise and the glory for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We'll ask you to stand again. We have a few songs we're going to sing in a row. We'd ask you to stand through all of them as the ushers even come up and take up the offering and remain standing until... It is this. Thank you.
Jason and Ross, we want to thank you, Lord, that your arms are wide open, Lord, and that you will pardon us when we fail you. Lord, I just give you all the praise and I give you all the glory. Thank you for the many blessings that you gave, not only to myself, but everyone in this building, Lord. I just ask that we always come to you on our knees and looking up to you. Lord, just bless us all and use the upkeep of thy kingdom, for it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
children's church this morning.
Christian marriages were fulfilling the will of God and a model of what God intended marriages to be, then there would be a far less lost people in our communities today. Husbands and wives, it is vital that we don't just skip through life holding hands, ignoring the battle that rages on around us, for too many times we have made happy marriages the mission that Jesus gave us. But that is not the full extent of the mission. Marriage is certainly important, but it's not most important. When we focus on what is most important in our marriages will thrive. They will be functioning as God designed and intended them to be. I often say during premarital counseling that I want to do everything possible through the leading of Christ to help marriages not just survive, but I want them to thrive. I want them to be thriving, not just getting by, not just hanging on by a thread, not just existing and making it through. And today we're going to look at a few passages. I was reading a book by Francis Chan and his wife called You, Me, and Forever, which gave me some inspiration for this message, but we're going to look at a few passages that are not your typical Valentine's Day week passages, but I believe they will truly strengthen and they will truly grow our marriages. And if you're not married, this will perhaps give you a tool to put in your toolbox to prepare for a healthy marriage one day in the future, should the Lord bless you with that. If you were once married, but perhaps your spouse has passed, or maybe you're no longer married, perhaps you'll never be married again, this is still a message for you as it calls us to our mission with Christ. The very first thing in this message today, if you're taking notes, the very first thing I want us to walk away with is the mission has to be priority. The mission has to be priority. In Matthew 28, many of us know this passage. We're given the Great Commission by our Lord just after the resurrection, just before his ascension into heaven. Matthew 28, verse 19 and 20 says, "Go therefore and make disciples." Now, where are we supposed to do that? Of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. The very fact that this was a command from our Lord Jesus should be enough that it takes priority in our lives. Amen? The very fact that it was written in the letters that are read, that should be enough to tell us that it is should be a priority in our lives. Even though all the commands of Christ should be a priority in our lives, especially this one, because we got to keep in mind, envision the scene of Jesus had just died and rose from the dead. He'd been with his disciples for 40 days, and now is the brand new resurrected King of the universe just delivering this message to his disciples just before ascending to heaven. Oh man, we've got to hang on to those last words. We've got to hang on to those important words that he gives us just before he goes, ascends into heaven. And if we ignore the mission to make disciples, then perhaps this would be one of the dumbest things we could ever do. Our lives should focus and prioritize the mission. Make disciples. Our marriages should prioritize making disciples. Being an example to others as well in our marriages. In order to disciple others in our marriage, we need to be living an example of the love of Christ. Our lives should be centered around the mission to make disciples. And this should impact the way we live. This should impact the way we give. This should impact the way we spend our money. It should impact our decisions. Our marriages and our lives exist in order to make disciples. And in order for our marriages to make disciples, the mission, we must be focused. So the second thing is the mission is focused. It's focused. Paul gave a word to 2 Timothy, to his disciple, in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 and 4. He says, share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in the concerns of civilian life. He seeks to please the commanding officer. We must remember, church, that we have been given a mission, and we cannot allow ourselves to get entangled in the concerns that are meaningless, that mean nothing. In other words, we need to keep the mission of God in our focus. It needs to be the pursuit. It must come before all else. Just picture for a moment a nice family in a neighborhood home. Your family's hanging out. You're playing cornhole. You're just enjoying time on the deck and just having a good time, maybe playing cards, eating on the grill. And just down the street, your neighbors and your friends are in an all-out war. War is happening. They're fighting for their lives. And later on, you're cleaning up for a get-together with friends in a couple of days, even remodeling a room in the back. You even decide to have the window company come and install new windows to tune out the noise just down the street. And you bought a new leaf blower to blow off the ash and the dust off the porch and the driveway from the war that's raging just down the street. It's kind of a crazy, embarrassing picture. But just maybe this is what a lot of marriages portray as they pursue a happy life but ignore the mission of Christ. Ignore the mission of Jesus. They made happy marriage the mission and not the mission of the Great Commission. The mission. Mark 8:35 says, for whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life because of me and the gospel will save it. Certainly, a part of the mission is a healthy marriage. And the mission certainly doesn't call us to neglect our marriages by any means. But we have to keep in mind that a marriage cannot be fully healthy, fully thriving, fully what God intended it to be unless we are following the words of Jesus in Matthew 6:33, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. Seeking first His kingdom, His mission, that's what it's about. So thirdly, the mission gives purpose to our marriages. You see, being at war together keeps couples from being at war with each other. Are you with me, church? We are in a battlefield against the enemy to win lost people to Christ, to share in the Great Commission of Jesus Christ, and being at war together in the mission, united in the mission, that keeps us from being at war with each other. When we center our marriage around the mission, our marriages grow in purpose. Because you were created for a purpose. A toaster is made to toast things. A vacuum cleaner is made to vacuum things. A hammer is made to drive a nail. A car is made you to get from is made to get you from point A to point B. And you were designed by the great designer, the God of the universe, for a specific purpose. Let me tell you, church, I get great fulfillment. I love to use the gifts that God has given me for the upbuilding of His kingdom. Amen. It's not anything that I have, but it's things that I've only been given because of His great blessing. I get great joy in preaching. I get great joy in teaching and serving others. And each of us, if you are a child of Christ, you have been given gifts and abilities. And I know many of you find great joy when you're able to use those gifts for the upbuilding of His kingdom and His purposes. It's what God created you for. That's right. And so joy comes from the fulfillment of His purpose in your life. Not only are you designed for a specific purpose, but your marriage, your marriages are designed for a specific purpose. Our marriages, they should be bright and shining examples of the relationship that Christ has with His church, the bride of Christ. Ephesians 5:25, Paul said, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for her." Have you ever gone through a stage in your life where you just thought, well, this can't be all that there is? Have you ever felt like everything was meaningless, everything was routine, just you were going through the humdrum motions of life? Have you ever felt like something inside of you just knows that you were created for more than what you're currently doing? Life is good, relationships are okay, but something is missing. You want to touch God rather than just talk to Him. You want to be in His presence rather than just hear His will for your life. You want to be engulfed deeply by the power of the Holy Spirit. This only happens when you are on mission for Him. There is nothing like it when you are on His mission with your life and with your marriage. So many times as we begin to get older, I've seen people begin to worry. Am I enough? Did I do enough? Or I wish I had done more for the kingdom instead of wasting so much time, so much money on things that have no eternal impact. You know, this is the time in our lives when we should be stirred to forget the past, to press into the future, to have more devotion, more drive for the Lord than we have ever had in our entire lives. God wants a generation of the next generations and elderly who are willing to keep pressing, to keep sharing, to keep serving, those who are willing to change, even though on the inside they're resistant to it. The younger generations, they need you as an example. They need you as an example of men and women who are willing to set the bar high, who are willing to set the example of repentance, that parts of their lives have been focused on things that don't really matter rather than on the things of God. An example of how to change their lives and their marriages to reflect Christ rather than the world. Husbands, your mission is to reflect the love of Christ. The love of Christ that love that He had for His church for your wives. That's your mission. Meaning you're laying aside your needs to serve hers. Meaning you're sacrificing your desires and your needs for hers. Wives, your mission is to reflect the love that the church should have for Christ. Her groom, and your love for your husbands, being willing to respect and follow your husband who is supposed to be leading the family in a godly manner. See, the older we become, the more excited we should be about being on mission to reflect Christ. It should stir our bones up. It should get our blood boiling, wanting to serve the Lord Jesus Christ and being on mission for Him. We don't go into autopilot. We don't go into retirement from serving the Lord. Wouldn't it be great if we could just look back and say with confidence, as Jesus did in John chapter 17, verse 4, He said, "I have glorified You on the earth by completing the work You gave Me to do," speaking to His Father. Wouldn't it be great if we could look back like that? Paul, as an older man who was nearing the end of his life, assures Timothy that it is all worth the pursuit of the mission. Even after the beatings that he endured, even after the imprisonments that he went through, even after all the temptations, all of it, even after all of it, he knew where his reward was lying. He knew where his reward was. He knew it was all worth it. And he encouraged Timothy to stay focused on the mission no matter how hard it may get. 2 Timothy chapter 4, 5 through 8. It says, "But as for you, exercise self-control in everything. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering. And the time of my departure is close. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. There is reserved for me the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only me, but to him, but to all those who have loved his appearing. You want to be able to look back and say, I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race. Do we want to look back and know we have accomplished what God wanted us to accomplish? The next thing I want us to take away from this morning is the mission unites marriages. The mission unites marriages. My wife and I, we have a lot in common. But there's certain things that we don't have in common. Even though we both like to play and we both like to coach sports, I love watching sports. She doesn't so much. I play an instrument and sing. Her, not so much. I like cherry-flavored slushies and snow cones. Not her cup of tea. I cannot cook very well. She certainly can. I love corny dad jokes. It's not her thing. And furthermore, and one simply by God's design, is the fact that I cannot get pregnant. She can. Praise the Lord. But let me in. Let me let you in on something. I love Jesus. She loves Jesus. And that is the number one thing that unites us. Amen. I love Jesus as she loves Jesus. We have a joint love for the mission of God and being a part of what God is doing. We love seeing what God is doing, seeing people repent of their sin, turn to Jesus as Lord, and be filled with the Holy Spirit. We love seeing that together. I love watching my wife share her faith and her joy in the Lord and her peace with Christ. I love it. I love seeing her disciple others and counsel others in the faith and in the biblical truth. And to be fully honest, I get all the more attracted to her when I see her doing those things. That's what unites us even more. We love being on mission together and staying focused on the mission and on the task with the mission unites our marriages even more. Paul encouraged us to strive together for the faith. Philippians 1:27, Paul said, just one thing, as citizens of heaven, live your life worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then whether I come and see you, or I'm absent, I'll care about you, and you, that you are standing firm in one spirit, in one accord, contending together for the faith of the gospel. You see, Paul's desire for the Philippians is our desire for our marriages, to be united in one accord, side by side, in the gospel mission, to make his name known, to make his name proclaimed, to lift his name higher. We teach our teams that we coach, that we win as a team and we lose as a team. Well, in marriage and on mission together, we're either winning as a team or we're losing as a team. This unity we have is birthed out of serving the Lord together. Those of you that have ever gone on a mission trip somewhere and spent some substantial time together on missions, you know exactly what this is like as you build special bonds with individuals and friends as you focus on the mission of Christ. The mission is what unites you. This wasn't something you set out to do, but it happened as a result of the goal of accomplishing the mission. Later on today, the 49ers will face off against the Chiefs in the Super Bowl. And when the 49ers win today, they will have formed a bond. They will have formed a bond today as they strive together to accomplish their goal of winning the Super Bowl. me tell you, church, there is unexplainable unity when people or a husband or a wife begin following the Holy Spirit and fulfilling the mission of God in their lives. There's unexplainable unity. For many in our world today, and even many Christian men and women, the goal has been to be a good mom, a good dad, a great husband, a great wife. And all those things are great, but if we have not been focusing on being a man of God and the woman of God, a great lady of the Lord, a great follower of Jesus Christ, then all of that is meaningless. See, the goal is not to have a marriage, centered marriages. The goal is to be and have Christ-centered marriages. Christ-centered marriages. Because to be fully honest, when our marriages are focused on Christ, and when they're putting Him first in our family, then and only then will our marriages be part of the mission of seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Then and only then. So today I challenge you, husbands, lead your wives in this mission. Be the man of God that He's called you to be. Be the husband that He's called you to be by leading your family and your spouse on mission together in the Great Commission to make disciples, to share Jesus with others. Be a part of that mission together. Perhaps your spouse isn't interested in the mission. And I encourage you to be that example. Pray, 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 as you have a mission before you as well. Pray for them. Don't ever give up. Keep loving them as Christ loved the church. Keep loving them as God called you to love them. I invite you, husbands and wives, to be on mission for Christ, because He is the only one worth living for. The only mission worth pursuing. I invite you today, if you've never surrendered to Jesus Christ, that today perhaps would be the day that you don't go another day without Him. That's the greatest decision you will ever make, is to surrender to Jesus and begin following His mission for your life. Would you bow your heads and pray with me and stand together? Father, we thank You for today. God, we thank You for Your word, Your truth. God, I pray that You would draw us unto You. God, that You would help us to prioritize the mission, to make it the focus. God, that it would unite us in our marriages, in our relationships, in our walk with You, Lord. God, I pray today, if there's somebody that doesn't know You, that haven't surrendered to You, Jesus, as Lord and Savior, the one who died on the cross, the one who rose again to forgive us of our sin. I pray today that they would say, Lord, I'm going to follow You and surrender to You, Jesus. God, I pray that You unite us in our marriages, that You build them stronger than ever because we're pursuing the mission of God. May that be our prayer this morning. In Jesus' name. Let's sing together.
this morning, I want to remind you of time together, fellowship, sharing the love of one another, supporting our youth as they get ready to go on mission this summer. So come enjoy a good chili. It's by donation. Just have a good time together. Again, if you haven't signed up for our love banquet that we're having on Wednesday night, we hope you'll do that. Whether you have someone to come with you or not, we're going to share the love of Christ together as a family. So I hope you'll come. It's always a good time together, just a joy to spend in the Lord together. I'm going to ask Jamie to close us out in prayer. Go ahead and bless the food as well. And hope everyone has a wonderful afternoon. And we do look forward to hope you'll come back out tonight. Those of you that would like to go visiting with us, we want to go and share the love of Jesus Christ and be on mission together. To visit some of our shut-ins and those that can certainly use our love as they miss this church dimly. Have a blessed day. Yeah.
Heavenly Father, God, we just come to you. Thank you so much, Lord, that you are, God, you've chosen to make us part of your kingdom, Lord, that you allow us to have eternity in heaven with you. Lord, I pray that everyone's accepted that invitation, that they've come to know you as their Savior, that they put their lives in your hands, and sworn their obedience, Lord, to do what you call us to do. Chances are there are some here that haven't done that. Pray as they go out today that they remember the message, God, just not just the message of a bride and a groom, but Lord, as the church that is Christ's bride, let us be what he calls us to be so we can be the bride he calls us to be as the church. Lord, we love you so much. We thank you for everything you do. We ask your blessing on the food that we are about to eat. Let it give us strength so we can